It was over 20 years ago, and the business owner looks at me and he says, I can do a better job at every job in my company than the people who are doing those jobs. Good to know, I thought. No, that's not really what I thought. The first thing I thought is, well, I can tell you one thing that you're not very good at, and that's hiring talent. Reality avoidance. Being deluded. Happens. You see it in all kinds of circumstances. And we do it. We all do it. We con ourselves into believing things. We con ourselves into believing that we're better at something than we really are. We might even con ourselves in the reverse. We may con ourselves into believing that we're bad at something that we really are quite good at. Self-delusion. It happens. It happens, and you see it all the time, and maybe you see it in your own life. How do we come to grips with who we really are? How do we come to grips with what we're really good at? How do we come to grips with what we're really bad at? Well, is it a good barometer for us to base it on what other people tell us? Mom and Dad always told me I could sing. My friends tell me I can sing. And then we go on American Idol and we get ripped to shreds. Because guess what? We can't sing. We think we can sing. And do what you love, because the odds are, experts tell us, that what you love to do, you'll be good at. I love to sing. I sing all the time. But you can't sing. But you think you can sing. Okay, well, that's not a good barometer either. What can you do? What can you spend your time doing? And you just lose all track of time, because that's likely to be something you're going to be pretty good at. I can sing for hours and hours and hours and lose all track of time. But you're not very good at singing. Okay, well, that doesn't work either. What are you successful at? What works? Well, how am I going to gauge that? I love to sing. I can lose track of time at singing. Other people tell me I can sing good and I can sing well, but I mean, it's not like I do it for a living or anything. How am I going to judge that? We see stories of self-delusion all the time, and sometimes the story might be, well, it may be that story in the mirror looking back at us. I watched a documentary the other day, actually a news magazine program. A fellow had been convicted of murdering his wife. He had professed his innocence all along. And detectives had realized that he had made a phone call, and he claimed that he'd made this phone call from an hour away from his home. But, you know, cell tower technology betrayed him and showed that he had made this phone call about 2 hours, or 2 miles rather, from his house where his wife was murdered. But he thought he was the smartest guy in the room. In fact, his defense attorney had warned him, you don't need to take the stand. Oh, no, he insisted he was going to take the stand because, as his defense attorney said later, he thought he was the smartest guy in every room he ever entered. And I told him, you're pompous, you're arrogant, you're not likable. This isn't going to translate well for you. And sure enough, it didn't. Deluded, believed he was smarter than everybody else. Till he was sentenced, found guilty and sentenced. Now, you may not be facing prison time. Hopefully, that's not the case. And surely, you've not murdered anyone. But you can just as easily practice self-deception just like he did, conning yourself into believing that you are one thing when you're not at all. I read an interview, and it was rather interesting to me because you so rarely see it, and it was quite refreshing. A business owner who had hired a CEO. Well, friends said, "You're crazy. What are you doing? Hiring somebody to be your boss?" "Yeah." "Yeah," he said, because he wasn't good at it. He said, "I'm not good at it. This isn't my strength. I'm not good at management. I'm not good at operations. I'm not good at systems and things." So he hired somebody who was. Well, hooray for him. Now we think, I could never do that. I could never do that. I could never show such weakness. You know what he thought? And it was rather brilliant, stupidly brilliant, if there is such a thing. He wanted to be freed up to do the very thing that he was really good at. Marketing. He didn't want to bother with all that other stuff. Because he wasn't that good at it. He wanted to be liberated. He wanted to be freed up to do the very thing that he was really good at. And so he hired somebody else who was vastly better at the stuff he was not very good at. Well, chop my legs off and call me shorty if that's not one of the most brilliant things going. And here's the really stupid thing about it all. You know how stinking rare that is? I mean, hardly anybody does that. No, nobody's going to tell us what to do. I've been on a crusade here lately. I admit it. This is an absolute weakness that I have. I get irked by something, and then I just go crazy with it. And I've been crazy lately with sales problems because everywhere I turn, I'm encountering some boob who believes that he's gifted and great at selling, and incompetence does not even touch the hem of it. I'm just terrible, dreadful, awful, pathetic. People that won't listen, people that are all about pitching, people that know what they want to say, don't care at all what the prospect is going to say or what the customer says, and they just absolutely tear off. And you're sitting there thinking, if you would just shut up, you would learn something. I've been on way too many sales calls lately where I'm just kind of the, you know, fly on the wall, and you just watch it unfold and you can just see disaster happening before your very eyes. And these people are just too moronic to understand it, too stupid, too foolish, too ignorant, too arrogant to recognize their own buffoonery. Well, it happens. It happens to all of us. All of us have, you know, we have this propensity, it seems, to avoid reality, to avoid coming to grips with how things really are, because self-awareness is such a difficult thing to do. Oh, self-examination? Sure, I can examine myself. I'm great. Wonderful. This is all terrific. Then there are those people who, you know, it doesn't matter how good they are or how talented they are or what kind of feedback or success they have, they think they're awful. You know people like that? Sure. Now, they're both equally pathetic figures. Yeah, the person who, yes, they're achieving some success, but they just, that was awful. I feel so bad. You know, and you're constantly trying to prop up this person and you're trying to show them, look, this is going good for you. That's going good for you. Yeah, but it's just, you know, I could have done better. It's just, you know, you eventually just get tired of it, right? I mean, it's just a whiner and a complainer. But even more pathetic, for me at least, is the person who just believes that they are so great. They are so wonderful. And in the face of tremendous evidence to prove the contrary, they just... It's not optimism. It's delusional is what it is. And it can drive me out of my mind. But how do you find that balance? How do you find that balance between what you are what you are good at, and how do you come to grips with the fact that I don't have to be the best at everything? As a business owner, do you have to be able to do everybody's job in the company better than they can do it? You ever watch Undercover Boss? Just watch one episode of Undercover Boss. I DVR this thing because it's just too cool. It's just too cool of a show. Well, the boss leaves the corporate office and he goes out into the field and he doesn't do any of those jobs very well. And these are name brand companies for the most part. So what? In most cases, what the boss finds out, man, he or she is thankful that they've got people out in the field who are good at those jobs. Because, boy, the company's success hinges on it. But imagine a boss in a corporate office who believes that he can do every frontline job better than those people who are doing it. I mean, what a sad, pathetic soul that person is. I don't know. Somewhere along the way, I guess we fell in love with the whole notion of the Renaissance man or the Renaissance woman, the person who can do anything and everything. And somewhere along the line, there is this competitive spirit that we can't acknowledge that you are better at something that I'm not so good at. I mean, it's just, we know logically that we are not all created equal when it comes to our talents, our abilities, our opportunities. But we want to act like we can do everything. It's, you know, it's mom and dad teaching little junior. He can be anything that he wants. No, he can't. No, he can't. Don't lie to your kids. You can't be anything that you want to be. Sorry. Hate to bust your bubble, but it's not going to happen because guess what? We're all people. We are mortal. Oh my. You've done it now. You've gone and burst my bubble. I'm 54. I'm never going to be a brain surgeon. Well, you know, boy, that just crushes me so. I'm never going to be a rocket scientist. I'm not going to be some world-renowned physicist. So, I mean, there are people that would tell you, you know, you're not much of a vlogger either or a podcaster. Well, that's okay. Some of us are just hard-headed enough, you know, that we're going to do it anyway. I was watching Biography Channel the other day, and they had an episode on Billy Crystal. At some point, Billy Crystal thinks he's going to really get his break, right? He's going to get his national break. Hadn't had it yet. He had a 6-minute segment. He was not on the cast of Saturday Night Live, but he was going to be given a 6-minute segment. There was a routine that he had developed, and yes, it was a long routine, but it needed it for setup and what he was doing. And it went well in rehearsal, Saturday Night Live being a live show. But Lorne Michaels knew that the show was running long. Something had to give. Andy Kaufman was scheduled to do some skit, and Lorne Michaels was rather determined, that stays. We're gonna air that. Dick Ebersol was the executive producer. He really wanted Billy Crystal's routine to stay. Well, it didn't. It got cut. Now, the family and friends, all it was going to be Billy's big break. They don't know that the break was not going to happen. He leaves. He gets in a subway. He goes home. Friends and family, they're waiting with bated breath. No Billy Crystal. Break didn't happen. Well, not that night. Billy Crystal had tremendous work ethic, and he kept on, 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 and he got a break. Seth Godin calls it the dip. It's that space between where we're at, assuming that where we're at is not success, and where we want to be. Far yonder shore over there, where success is. Well, how far is it from here to there? Don't know. Well, how long will it take me to get from here to there? Don't know that either. Just go. Swim. Swim, swim, swim. Keep swimming, keep swimming. At some point, we hope, no guarantees, right? We hope that we are closer to success. We're closer to that other shore than we are the shore that we left behind, which represents, let's say, failure. Well, or not success. But we don't know, so we keep on swimming, and we keep on swimming, and we keep on swimming. Will our break come? Don't know. Don't know. It won't come if you don't keep on. And as we're swimming through this dip, here's the hope. The hope is that along the way, we come to grips with what works, what doesn't work, with where our strengths are, where our weaknesses are. And hopefully, as we're swimming, we can become more skillful at knowing ourselves. My name is Randy Cantrell. That much I know. I have a website. I this too know. BulaNetwork.com is the name of said website. And this is, well, this is my lair. This is where I hold forth. You be the judge whether I hold forth very well or not. But hey, I'm holding forth. I'm in the dip, right? I'm swimming. I'm swimming. I'm swimming. And I happen to be doing my swimming here in the Yellow Studio.